Okay, so I think that we're live now. And I'm really delighted to have you here, Ritu. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you so much, Kira. Thank you so much for inviting me for this webinar.
Absolutely, absolutely. I'm just going to introduce our wonderful guest speaker today. This is part of the Oxford's Program in Comparative Media Law and Policy Global Media Policy Seminar Series, which is totally online. It's all virtual. And our wonderful guest speaker today is Ritu Srivastava, who is a co-conveyor of the Community Network Exchange Asia Pacific region. She has over 8 years of experience working with community networks and in information and communication technology more broadly. And she currently focuses a lot of her work on ICT, so information and communication technology at the grassroots level. And she works a lot on issues relating to gender and gender recognition in that space. She is also the author of the policy paper, Community Networks, Regulatory Issues and Gaps, Experiences from India, which is published by the Internet Society and the Digital Empowerment Foundation. And so her talk today is going to be on the regulatory and licensing framework for community networks in the Asia Pacific region. And we're really delighted to have her here because she obviously has a lot of expertise in that area. And before I hand it over to Ritu to give a little presentation to get us started, I'm just going to tell you a little bit about the Global Seminar Series. So the Global Media Policy Seminar Series, which this talk is a part of, is a series of online talks hosted by the University of Oxford, the Program in Comparative Media Law and Policy. And the idea is to bring together expertise and perspectives from the Global North and the Global South on current issues in media policy. And anyone, anywhere can join for free online. And the recordings of all of the seminars will go up on our YouTube channel after the fact. So if you miss it, no big deal, you can catch up later. So without further ado, I will hand it over to Ritu, who is going to frame the discussion for us.
Yeah. Thanks, Kira. I will share my screen first and then start the presentation. So thank you so much, Kira. I have designed this presentation with respect to community networks. Since I have been working in with community networks from the last 8 years, and presently I am also working with three of the community networks in India specifically. The first community network, which is managed by Digital Empowerment Foundation. The second community network, where I'm trying to be an advisor for them, is a Seva Mom, which primarily provides health services to community network using community networks. And lastly, where I'm trying to engage the community networks along with the gender aspect and how the gender can be integrated to the community networks, trying to build up the how women should engage with community networks. In this presentation, I have focused primarily on the community networks and what are the regulatory and policy environments around community networks. Then I have, as we go forward, the presentation will have five different parameters. First is a policy and telecom regulatory environment. Second is a spectrum management and availability of a spectrum. Third is a backhaul, a broadband and the backhaul connectivity. And the lastly, which I'm trying to focus more on, a USO fund, which is available for operators, or we can call them for the purpose of a community networks. It can be provided for the purpose of community networks. However, I would like to start with what do we mean by community networks is that it's a community-owned telecom infrastructure where it is a crowdsourced infrastructure which is managed by community itself, managed by community itself and operated by community itself. And it has been seen from a non-discriminatory, as a non-discriminatory network, which is free and open to all people. In across the world, there are about 100 community network operators, primarily located in Asia-Pacific region, North America, and Africa, in all across the world. These community network operators are primarily very small operators, those who make the use the low cost devices and try to make the infrastructure by themselves. So even though if we say that these community networks have a common characteristics like sharing and manage the network by themselves, however, each community radio community network face the different level of challenges depending upon their political and economic as well as the
Oh, it seems like we might have lost Ritu for a moment there. Ritu, can you still hear me?
If I'm not sure whether I have the connection was lost or not, but going ahead, the first I have divided the regulatory environment in a 5 different ways: policy and regulatory mechanism, spectrum availability, licensing and the management of the spectrum, broadband and backhaul, and universal service fund, or you people do call it as a universal service obligation fund. When we go forward, we will see what are the characteristics of each parameters where it falls actually. The policy and regulatory mechanism of any telecom industry, any country has a different set of a regulatory mechanism for their telecom operators. It is primarily set by the government and the state to regulate the telecom operators, not only to regulate the telecom operators, but to regulate the spectrum, to regulate the process of the licensing basis, to regulate the small network operators as well as the big telecom regular operators, those who take the license actually. Those who do not take the license, they still have to maintain some regulations and norms, but it also depends upon the country, and it also depends upon the what kind of a regulatory mechanism falls in their country zone and economic zone. Specific with respect to Asia specific, when we talk about what kind of a policy and regulatory mechanism are there which favors or not favors community networks, India, most of the Asian countries have a controlled competition and has a nature of a ownership reforms, which also allows them a limited and a controlled competition is there within the countries itself. In most of the Asia Pacific countries have a competition reform, which means that the government, even though there is a private stakeholdership and private telecom operators are allowed, but the government still owns the higher stake in those operations and mechanism actually. For example, in India, there was a telecom operator, there is a telecom operator, state-owned telecom operator, BSNL, which is primarily a state-owned telecom operator, and it is managed by the government itself. Similarly, in Myanmar and Philippines, again, the telecom operators are, they are state-owned telecom operators as well, and state-owned telecom institutional mechanism as well, where private sectors are allowed to come, but the major stakeholdership is with the government. If we understand that particular scenario, that sometimes it is a favoritism, it's good for a community networks if the competition is built around it and the government is flexible to provide provide more resources or more competition to the small operators, which helps the community networks to build those kind of a networks in those places where there's no telecom operator. So it is really important to have a healthy competition as well as a number of players to be around, actually, instead of a monopolization of a one telecom operator in the entire country, which does not help sometimes because it raises a lot of questions about backhaul connectivity. It raises a lot of a question about universal access to services and universal access to connectivity. The one of the basic challenge what we face in most of our telecom and regulatory mechanism is the tedious process and the documentation to engage with regulatory bodies. For example, in India, if we have to get a license or if we have to deal with the operators and we have to get certain kind of a things, we have to deal with the 5 to 6 government departments for the documentation process to maintain the compliances, even if we are acting as a community network provider. It is challenging for a small net operator to maintain those kind of processes and documentations. The licensing processes is really jargon-based language. It is difficult to understand for a small operator if they really want to operate, actually. The process of auctioning is not clear. The process of a licensing policy is not clear. It is hidden. It is like in a layers of a files, so it is not so clear to the small operators. Then there's lastly, high administrative burden on an operator and a regulator. So the some of the solutions that it is there is a very simplify the process to engage, and the it can be the unified licensing process to make the small operators to understand the regulatory framework and licensing framework easily. And then simply authorization system can also help the community networks to leverage it, as most of a high administrative burden on the operator is to maintain not only to pay the taxes but also to coordinate with the regulator as well as maintaining the liabilities belonging with the state, as well as if there's a sub region, to maintain the liabilities with the region wise as well. So in those process, it is a really tedious processes for any small operator to maintain all the processes and documentation. There are number of operators, community network operators, those who are managing it, but it's really challenge for a community network operators to maintain those kind of a documentation every quarterly or every yearly as well. Like for example, in India, you have to submit your not only to tax information, but also you need to submit your user log in every 3 months, which is a challenge actually, which is a challenge for every things to be done actually. So user log has to be maintained, compliances has to be maintained as per the policy and regulatory. It is a challenge for the community network operator. Let's talk about the spectrum availability and management. The International Telecommunication Union has given an unlicensed spectrum. Unlicensed spectrum, or we call it as a free spectrum, is the spectrum where it is where any operator do not pay any cost to the government for using that spectrum. In a simpler way, the spectrum, these spectrum is mandated by the ITU to be used as a to be called as a free spectrum or an unlicensed spectrum, and it can be used by any operator. 2.4 gigahertz, 5 gigahertz, and 60 gigahertz are supposed to be a unlicensed spectrum. 2.4 gigahertz and 5 gigahertz is the most common unlicensed spectrum, which is being used by most of the countries, whether it's India, whether it's US, Argentina, Mexico, across the world. The 60 gigahertz is the spectrum which is freely available in US and Canada. However, it is not available in most of our Asia Pacific countries. In specifically like country like Myanmar, they do not have a 60 gigahertz of a spectrum. Country like Myanmar, do not have any specific policy around unlicensed spectrum as well. And even though it is mandated by the by ITU, but still the community network ASCOM is facing the challenge on establishing the community network. For example, ASCOM has built the community network using the 2.4 gigahertz and 5.0 gigahertz band. However, the government stated that these two bands are creating a high interference. So they have to redesign the entire infrastructure as per the government government mandate. They used unlicensed spectrum 5 gigahertz for the backhaul connection and 2.0 gigahertz for the connection inside the villages. So it is a situation when the countries do not even allow to use the unlicensed spectrum as well. There are other bands like microwave band, 60, as I talked about, 60 gigahertz band, which is also known as a V band, and also E band, which is from 71 gigahertz onwards, are also used without licenses. So these progressive countries are US and Canada, where microwave bands are allowed to use it. There are talks in India to use 60 gigahertz band, V band. However, it is not as part of a policy. It is not yet allowed to be used microwave bands. The third kind of a spectrum, which is really available in most of a country, in everywhere, when we have moved from which is called TV white space. In a very simple way to understand what is TV white space is that when we shifted from an analog TV to the digital TV, the band which is 50 megahertz to 700 megahertz is now freely and available for the further use. So which can be further utilized for providing a wireless broadband internet connectivity. There are specific countries which are progressive towards TV white space. US, Canada, South Africa, these days Nigeria has also drafted a TV white space policy. Recommendations are yet waited in Nigeria. Countries like Argentina, Brazil, Mexico are moving towards TV white space. But if you see the countries in Asia Pacific countries, we are still far behind. Country like India, Pakistan, or even in most of us Asia Pacific countries do not have a TV white space. We are not allowed to use, we do have a TV white space, but we are not allowed to use TV white space for providing the wireless broadband and internet services. The one good example that which was in India, that there was an experimental license given to academic institution IIT Bombay to understand the innovative uses of TV white space. Even though it was a successful implementation, which came out as a result, which the Grammar came out as a community network provider, community network solution. But government did not pursue TV white space further. That does not mean that TV white space is not useful. TV white space is widely useful, but it depends upon the political and economic as well as telecom lobbies who are considering the TV white space. So there's a huge demand for TV white space, but depending upon the political and telecom lobbies scenario, the TV white space in most of our Asia Pacific countries are not allowed to use. Then the third is the broadband and backhaul. Let me define the term. What do we mean by the broadband and what do we mean by the backhaul? Broadband definition in most of our countries is given by minimum download and upload limit, which is varies from a 256 kbps per second to 1.5 megabits per second on a higher end. Each country has their own specific broadband definition. The backhaul is the connectivity which is the last drop by the any telecom service provider who has given the last, or we can say the where he has given a last drop of the internet, actually, that we call the backhaul. These two terms are really important for a community network provider. It is one of the advocacy tool as well, where any community network provider can use it that to engage with their policy and telecom regulatory bodies, actually. Like, for example, in Asia Pacific region, the entry level broadband definition is very low. 256 kbps is for Fiji and Pakistan. 512 kbps is for India. And till 2011, India was also following 256 kbps for as a broadband definition. What it means that we have a 256 upload and 256 download limit, actually. So, and now we have a 512 kbps, which is for India, Bhutan, Cambodia, and other Sri Lanka and Indonesia, actually. Bangladesh is ahead of us, which has a 1 Mbps as a broadband definition. Brunei is ahead of us. Countries like Laos, Myanmar, and Philippines, they do not have any broadband definition. So it is vague to for any telecom operator or any user to understand what broadband is being provided to me as and what is the minimum requirement for a broadband. If I'm taking any line, if I'm taking any connection from the ISP, the user from Myanmar and Philippines will, depending upon the provider, they will say that, okay, we are charging you this much, we are charging you this much, but they have no specific definitions that how much they should minimum provide you to the user level. So for any user, understanding the broadband as well as understanding the things, it's really important. The broadband is important for the to understand when any user is trying to get the broadband connection or any connection in their home or in their industrial area or in any kind of a connectivity purpose. Similarly, that depending upon the broadband, any community network provider can also understand that if they are taking a backhaul connectivity from a traditional or from a big corporate providers, what should be the minimum broadband they should provide to the any community network provider, and how they should what should be the speed of that particular connection is coming up, and on that basis only the price and the cost is defined. So if 512 kbps is provided in India, the price of a 1 Mbps line is higher for us. So depending upon the definition, they will also say that this is the cost and this is the way we are providing. And we cannot fight on that. The last thing is which I'm talking about is a universal service fund. Universal service obligation fund is a mechanism established by the national governments to promote universal access to telecommunication services. What does it also mean that the tax which is collected by the traditional telecom providers is collected and it is also then again reused for the purpose of connecting those regions which are not connected, So it is really important for any government to not only allocate the service obligation fund, but also utilize the service obligation fund in an effective and efficient manner. There are a number of countries in a specific Asia Pacific region. They have a levy on a service obligation fund, like Bangladesh, Bhutan, Indonesia, Myanmar, Nepal do not have a service obligation fund. But in India, the service obligation fund is a 5% to the telecom operators, is a levy to the telecom operator on a revenue. What it means that whatever is the revenue of the operator, they have to pay 5% of the revenue to the service as a service. Bangladesh has a 1% on a mobile network operators. Indonesia has 0.75%, and Myanmar has kept 2% from all the licensees. What does it mean? That it means that they will collect the service obligation fund from a mobile network operators, from a broadband operators, from a ISP operators, from across whatever licensing they are provide to that. Again, Philippines has no service obligation fund, but the most of Asia Pacific countries have a service obligation fund. In a one way, it is really good that service obligation fund is provided, is there, which can be further utilized by small operators and community network operators to utilize those funds for reaching out those regions which are not connected by the traditional telecom operators. However, access to these funds is one of the major challenge. Most of the time, what we have seen in India, most of the time, these service obligation fund is utilized further by the government to set up the more infrastructure in rural regions, which is not is the case to be specifically required, because there's a infrastructure is there, but connectivity is not there. There are towers, but it is non-functional. There are existing infrastructures, but it is non-functional. So instead of using USO fund for establishing that infrastructure, it should be used for those telecom operators or given to those community network operators, those who want to use the existing infrastructure and also want to provide the connectivity and maintain the connectivity instead of establishing it for a further infrastructure. So on the basis of these things, I have suggested some of the points that whenever we have seen the policy and telecom regulatory mechanism, mostly the telecom operators, prime telecom operators or government stakeholders are the only part of our telecom regulatory proceedings. It is really important that community network experts or those who are working on those regions which are unconnected and regions should be the part of our regulatory processes. As I stated before, these regulatory mechanisms is not so transparent because they are jargon-based language, they are difficult to understand, technical languages are there. So it is really important to have a regulatory transparency need to be increased by making it simplified version and able that any layman person can understand the regulatory framework, and the transparency has to be maintained throughout the processes and what kind of a regulatory framework is there and what is meant for the user actually. So it is not that only technical person can understand, but any layman person can understand what is their telecom regulatory framework within their country. Increase the regulatory flexibility. As I have been stating from the beginning that specifically in Asia Pacific countries, there are rigid regulatory mechanism, they do. So it is important that we allow them. Regulatory framework should be flexible. Allow them to use unlicensed and license-free spectrum. There are number of unlicensed spectrums are available, which should be allowed to small operators to utilize it further. Then there should be incentive or recognition to the for community network providers, those who want to do a spectrum sharing and allow for further connectivity. The one of the major challenge what we face in our spectrum is that the auction and the price of the spectrum, the cost of a spectrum is very high for a small telecom operator, but also for a big or a traditional telecom operator. The spectrum fees is high. So even any mid-level or low-level operator wants to apply for a license, it is difficult not only difficult as for the documentation, but the cost is itself is very high. So it should be lower down the cost of a spectrum, specifically in a case of a special circumstances. For example, if the connectivity needs to be provided into tribal zone area where there is no one who wants to go, or conflict zone area, then it has to be the spectrum cost needs to be lower down. Or spectrum sharing capability. Connectivity can be provided to those specific zone areas. And lastly, the spectrum allocation needs to be transparent. In most of these spectrum allocation processes, it's jargon based, it's not so transparent. So it has to be transparent, and it has to be given to the given a number of community network providers need to come, as well as it has to be made publicly available that how they have done a spectrum allocation to different companies, to different operators, and how they are providing the connectivity in a uniform manner. Besides all of these points, the one of the things which I would like to highlight, most of the community network providers need to do a lot of a policy advocacy, or need to be keep on doing a work, whether it's sometimes it falls into the regulatory framework and sometimes it does not fall into the regulatory framework. However, they have to try out the permutation, set up a permutation combination that when it is working in a regulatory framework, how do they can channelize themselves to engage more with the government and create more best practices, so that government can understand that these alternative models or community network models are the are not only the solution, but also the future for the providing the uniform access to the connectivity. And for that purpose, regulatory mechanism has to be simplified for the small operators. Thank you so much, Kira. That's my presentation.
Great, thank you so much, Ritu, for that wonderful framing of the various regulatory and policy issues at stake in this sphere, especially in the Asia Pacific region. We really appreciate that. I'm going to go ahead and start us off with some kind of questions to continue the discussion, but I would like to encourage all of the viewers that are tuning in live to the webinar to ask questions as well. At the bottom of your screen, there should be an icon for Q&A, and if you click on that, you can submit questions, and I will be fielding those and sending them over to Ritu, so please do participate. We're also using a new platform. We haven't used Zoom webinars before. We just started using it for our last webinar with Jessa Lingle. And so we would also love the opportunity to play around with the Q&A function. So please do ask some questions, because that would be great. Basically, everything that you've been talking about, Ritu, has been kind of focused on this big issue of how do we enable more people to get online, especially in contexts where it's been historically difficult for them to do so, despite the rapid increase in accessibility of internet connectivity for many people across the world. So I'm just wondering if you could maybe tell us a little bit about what the situation is regarding internet access in India and in the Asia Pacific region more broadly. Why is getting online still an issue there?
Okay. Considering that in not only India, but Asia Pacific region is one of the biggest market for telecom providers, as well as companies like social media platforms as well, like Facebook, Twitter, and many other. And there are innovations which are being done by these OTT players as well, Facebook either or Google, or they are coming up with the connectivity solutions. However, the challenge is there are certain challenges which falls into the category of specifically in Asia Pacific region is the accessibility, affordability of the devices, reach out to the unconnected region is still a challenge. There are locations in India where there's no connectivity, where, for example, if I go out 2 hours drive from Bombay, there's no telecom tower. Even if there's a telecom tower, it's non-functional. The existing infrastructure is there, but it's non-functional. So the one of the challenges that we face is the not affordability of the devices, cost of the devices, cost of the internet and data prices. Mobile connection, definitely the penetration of a smartphone has increased the internet usage of our internet connectivity. However, if we talk about broadband, it is minimal. It is minimal. If there's no specific figures that how many people are using broadband connection, the data is, there's not enough research which talks about that how many people are using broadband connection and how many people are using the broadband connection for their purpose. Most of them are using mobile data or mobile, what we call it as a mobile broadband. So availability of the device, availability of the infrastructure is the another challenge. As I said, there are the infrastructure which is available, but it may be non-functional. So there are layers of challenges which integrate actually. The layers of a challenge, maybe the device is there, maybe I have the tower is there, but it is non-functional. So what should I do with the device? I can only go and use the mobile internet for certain time. So it may be for a two hours or 3 hours, or maybe for a depending upon my usage as well. Another thing is that accessibility of that particular content itself, or accessibility of that particular, how do I use or relevance of that particular network itself, whether I need it or I do not need it, that awareness is still missing. But in terms of infrastructure, availability of the device and the cost of the devices are the prime two main factors. And then whether I can afford or not, it depends actually. It depends upon that. Any community network provider which is trying to set up a community network in India itself, it will cost minimum $100,000. It is a huge cost for any small operator to set up, or minimum $2,000 to $3,000 for setting up of a network. It is a costly because we have to not only sustain the network, but also to understand what purpose it will be used for. And then on all of those challenges, then you have to maintain, any small network has to maintain all the compliances as well as the regulatory framework, which may and may not be favorable to any community network provider as well. May be favorable and may not be favorable for the community network provider. Sometimes the government ignores it. It is favorable for the community network provider. Sometimes if they keep an eye on you, it may not be favorable for the community network provider. So those are some of the basic challenges which any community network provider faces. Having said that point, mobile internet mobile has definitely increased the number of internet usage, but how many people are using it 24/7, or I should say like 8 hours in a day, specifically in rural regions, is the one of the things that we need to study a lot. There are a number of studies which are available, but how many of them are using like for a minimum for 8 hours? There's no study which talks about that. There's no study specifically in the Asia Pacific region. There's a very limited number of study research is being done. How many people are using it? What kind of a network they are trying to build it up? How many base stations exist in the country? So all those things are very less number of studies are available on that. How many base stations are there? How many towers are functional? How many towers are non-functional? These kind of studies are required to be done.
Great, thank you so much for that, Ritu. I was also wondering if maybe you'd like to unshare your screen, because then we'll be able to see you better as well, since now we're in the Q&A bit of the session. And we've gotten a couple great questions coming in, and I'm just going to ask one or two more myself before I move over to those. So basically, the situation is that big telecom providers, so network operators, are not really filling the gap here in a lot of cases. And I'm wondering, Ritu, what your personal journey has been in terms of working with community networks. How did you come, to be invested in community networks as a potential solution to that gap?
I think the one of the things that community network providers do is that they reach out to the places where there is where traditional telecom provider or a main ISP do not want to go, because of there is no return of investment, and that is the important for a community network provider to go there and set up the network to set up the network and make it available for the community itself. This is one of the reason that it's there, reason that they are working in such kind of locations actually. In my 8 years of a journey with the community network providers, I have seen that these community network providers are not only providing the connectivity for the purpose of providing the connectivity for the sake of providing the connectivity, like the way traditional telecom providers provide. They come up with the package, they come up with the kind of things like, okay, we will provide you the 100 Mbps, we will provide you this much, this much, this much, you know, whatever you want to do. This case is very different when we go to the rural side of the country. The rural side of the country do not only know how need to know the connectivity, but they also need to know, understand how it is best possible manner they can utilize it, how it is the best possible manner that they can afford it. So all those scenarios which integrated, then in an 8 year for the journeys where I have seen the community network providers are providing the connectivity for the purpose of livelihoods, the connectivity is the only medium, but the other things are surrounded by that particular for any community community basic needs itself, whether it's a livelihood, whether it's a trading services, whether it's health services, all of them are surrounded by that particular connectivity itself. While working in DF, where I have seen that connectivity has become only a medium, where women are coming and talk about the accessing these spaces and trying to come up with to utilize these spaces as a safe network zone. Similarly, I have seen with Seva Mom, where they are using this connectivity to access the maternal health information. So it depends upon the usage of the connectivity that they are using it actually. The scenario that there's a basic difference between when any traditional telecom provider provides the connectivity and when any community network provides the connectivity. Traditional telecom providers do not bother about what kind of how much connectivity you can afford. If I need only a 1 Mbps line, I don't need a package service of a 4 Mbps line or 100 Mbps thing. So that is a burden on me. So instead of providing that burdensome on me, I would say that, okay, please provide me this much particular thing in this much time, and then I don't want it because my income is not that much. But traditional operators will not do such a thing, because they will say my ROI, return of investment, will not come. I do not want to go for a one customer or a two customer, or even if a bunch of a customer, because there's a lot of infrastructure setup has to be done. Whereas a community network provider, it does not matter with them whether the connectivity is provided to them for a 1 Mbps or a 512 kbps, or it's only a Wi-Fi hotspot zone, or what should be the minimum cost that one particular user can bear. It can be 10 cents as well. It can be 50 cents as well. It can be $1 as well. Depends upon that the particular user need and what capability, how much time he needs it. So the instead of giving a full package of a services, the community network provider is going by the user need. One is a top-down approach, and another one is a bottom-up approach. So that's the basic difference. And this is why there's a state needs to understand, if you have a compatible, you want a competitive environment for a telecom, both kind of operators are required. If in a not only the major operators are required, but a small level of operators are required to play that vital role in those region where the connectivity is minimal, where there's no connectivity, or even if the connectivity is there, there is no usage pattern, no usage of them because they can't afford it. So both kind of operators are as equally required to maintain that competition in the environment actually.
Great, thank you so much, Ritu. So I'm going to give you a question now that's come in through our Q&A from France, who asks, which country, in your opinion, has the best regulatory environment for community network operators and could thus act as a potential template or a good practice benchmark for other countries? And I think, that could be, what country anywhere in the world do you think is a good example of that?
I'll not say that whether a country is good or bad as a regulatory environment, but having said that, there are countries like South Africa or Mexico or Brazil or Argentina are giving up a favorable policies toward community network providers. Besides that, India do not recognize community network provider as a channel to provide the uniform connectivity, but there are certain things that which is also favorable to us because ignorance is there within the policy and regulatory mechanism, which makes us favorable for a community network provider. So in that sense, countries like Mexico, Argentina are doing are favorable in terms of certain policies, but there are a number of challenges which exist in their like in most of our countries, like spectrum sharing is not allowed in most of our countries, or the Spain could be the one of the good example to see actually, because the GoofyNet as a community network provider is one of the best practices which I have ever seen.
And could you describe a little bit more about what makes it the best in your view?
The one of the things that GoofyNet has been doing is not only the sharing of a bandwidth or a network, but it also allows them to share the prices as well, existing infrastructure as well, which is not possible in India, which is like, even though India has a equipment sharing policy, telecom operators are not allowing the small operators to use their infrastructure, or the infrastructure is not allowed actually. So even if I have a policy, but it is not implemented properly, or even if it's not functional, it does not make any sense to the country actually. So not only the good as a policy recommendation, not only the country has to make the flexible and the user need for telecom policies, but they also need to implement effectively and efficiently, whether it is being played or not. Some examples I can trace it from India itself, like India has certain good things, but it is not implemented properly. So it is it's not used for us. But like Spain, they not only have a bandwidth sharing and the spectrum sharing policy, but they have also implemented properly.
Okay, yeah, that makes sense. So the next question that we have is from the ISOC live stream, actually. And by the way, thank you to ISOC for live streaming this as well. That's been brilliant. So the question from the ISOC live stream is, what is the main reason behind the high regulatory and administrative burden for small operators? Is it vested interest of a cozy relationship between incumbents and regulators, or is it some other reason?
I can drive the example from the India itself only if we talk about that, what are the administrative burdens we have as a regular, as a community network provider or as a operator itself, if we want to implement or install any device or anything, any network operator, or if as a small network operator, if I want to become a licensed base operator, I have to deal with 5 different departments. It is an administrative burden for a small operator, as well as it is a burden for the department as well, that it is not a streamlined process. Every process will take about 2 weeks to a month, and it is not disclosed to the previous department that how the processes are going. The processes are not streamlined. It becomes very cumbersome for a small operator to follow up with that administrative deals, actually. Then there are not only the taxes, but also the different inherent taxes, which are making the administrative burden for an operator, for any small operator, to manage that particular infrastructure. First of all, that you have to maintain all the devices, you have to maintain all those kind of infrastructure, then you have to share your, make your tax, everything, and you have to deal with 5 different departments. If I have to take any, apply for a license, I have to deal with 5 different departments, and all those 5 different departments do not coordinate with each other. One of the major problems, that they do not want to coordinate with each other. So it is every time a small operator has to go and deal with the different department in a differently manner. It's not a streamlined process. If there's a queue, and if I can from a I am starting my queue from the back, and I can go into the front like in a one by one step. It's an easy process for me. But if I'm in a random queue where I do not know where I have to go to reach that particular mark, I don't know, because in that same way, it's becoming an administrative burden for the applicant who is applying for the licensing, actually. Whether it's applying for a spectrum licensing, whether it's you apply for a small operator, to become a small operator in India, you have to apply for a licensing. Then you have to apply for you need to clear all those SECFA license, you need to understand airport guidelines. All those things are not given in a very proper manner in any of those zones. So for a small operator, it is really difficult to understand all those nuances, all those processes. Similarly, whether it's in other Asia Pacific countries like Myanmar or in the Philippines, it is not disclosed properly. What kind of things I have to document during the time of applying licensing, it's not disclosed properly. So when I'm applying, it may take not only for a, may take a 7 weeks, to may take a 6 months to apply it. So it is a challenge for a small operator to keep on following up with for the license process or with that submission. Even if you have got the license as well, there's still a huge amount of administrative work which has to go for a small operator, which is an administrative burden for a small operator to operate as well and to maintain these documentations as well.
Great, thank you so much, Ritu. So the next question that we have that's come in is, could you give advice to international donors on this theme? What is worthwhile funding in order to increase connectivity, employing community networks? What are some of the leading NGOs in that space? And maybe what regulatory efforts should be supported? So this is general advice to international donors.
what I have seen when I was studying for a mapping for a regulatory, my study itself, the one of the major requirement, what I feel there's not enough research and data available on what kind of a telecom policies are favorable or what kind of a telecom policies are favorable to various aspects, whether it's a favorable to community network providers or not, whether there's a requirement for a lot more research to be done in this particular domain zone areas. Many of the papers which talk about these days is the internet usage and usage patterns. But there's a lot more paper which is required to be simplified for the purpose of, or research required to be the purpose of, to understand what are these policies all about, why these policies are important for a common person to read and understand. There's a lot more things to need, and not only to talk about these policies, but to also make a curriculum or a structure for on these policies, so that we can give that on these policies, so that we can, any layman or any small operator can understand what are the telecom regulatory policies lie in their own country. For example, I had gone to Uganda, and I found that Uganda does not even know, that people were not even aware that what is backhaul, what is the small terms, or whether they do have an unlicensed spectrum or not. It is so hidden in the layers of a policy papers that any layman person cannot find it. So it is important to have those transparency level is not only to require to be come out of public space, but easily able to be accessible. There's a lot more research, and the data research needs to be done to understand these jargon based languages in a very simplified version instead of a very high defined version. There's a need to be made that to have a discussion around that any person can understand these policy discourses. And since these policy discourses change quite often, and these policy discourses are always dynamic, because every time there's either a spectrum auctioning is happening or certain things are happening on the around, we never know around it. So I personally will only focus on India policy, but maybe something elsewhere it's happening in other parts of the world. I should also be aware about that, so that I can do a good amount of a policy level of a discourse and action in my country. But these kind of according to me, suggestion is required. If I have to say that, a lot of research data has to be placed for the further study on the telecom policies. Simplify the version of telecom policy, identify the best practices who have favored, who have come out for this particular using some methods, and what did the method they try in terms of a regulation, in terms of what kind of a mechanism did they try when they are talking to regulators or licensing. Or what kind of a spectrum, even in the, not many researches available that how the spectrum is being allocated in my own country, or the spectrum fragmentation is happening in my own country. So there's a lot more research which is required to happen here as well. So and which should not be given to the big telecom operator. These research should be done by the small community network providers, so that who can understand the better scenario of their country. There's a need to understand how many existing infrastructure is available, so that we should not keep on pile on creating the new infrastructure. We should be able to use the existing infrastructure. So all those things are required for the purpose to understand the zone of a community network. Of course, there's a requirement of a community network to make it sustainable, or this protectively too, if any big funder wants to sustain the community networks, definitely not only they should give a funds for creating a new community network, but also give a fund for sustaining it and also give a fund for administrative work. There's a lot more administrative work which goes on a community network network provider in terms of maintaining the user log, to in terms of maintaining the complaints or in terms of a troubleshooting, but also a lot of a documentation work which goes for a community network provider. So the definitely the funds are more required for administrative work than the implementation work actually.
Do you have any examples of translating some of this more technical information and the policy information, which is really dense? It tends to be very dense and very impenetrable for ordinary people to understand. It's written sort of for regulators and telecommunications engineers. And I'm thinking specifically of maybe the example of the Digital Empowerment Foundation's initiative, the Wireless for Communities project, where they talk about training what they call barefoot engineers to work on the network and maintain the network. And I'm wondering how that works and whether that does some of this translation work that you're describing, whether that's been effective, or if you can think of other examples where this has actually worked and how.
Yeah, definitely, Kira. So one of the things that Digital Empowerment Foundation has done it, and it's also came through our experiences that when we were trying to implement the network, it is always seen that for implementing of the network, you need a technical people, and bringing the technical people from the urban location to the rural region, it is always challenging. Making them to understand the nuances of a network is very important. Making them to understand that how the network operates and managed, it's very important. The hesitant part is that people do not want to understand. When they listen the network word itself, it sounds them to the technical. It may and may not be the technical. It may be the more administrative job. It may be more other kind of a job instead of a technical job. But it is supposed to be said as a technical work. So the curriculum which is designed by us is specifically translates that how any common person or how any person who does not have any information about network can still set up a wireless network on its own. And the curriculum is designed in a way that it should be understood by through the format of an image, through the format of a storytelling, through the format of a video, so that any common person can easily understand. And instead of using a jargon-based language, the curriculum has tried to simplify the versions of a network and the nuances of network into different zones and by showing different images and all. That is one of the best one of the examples that I can recall. Another, like Association for Progressive Communication has made a policy and regulatory Wikipedia page where people are trying to contribute on a policy and regulatory framework so that people can easily understand what are the regulatory challenges within their country. The only challenge which is there actually that these policy and regulatory frameworks change a lot, and it's a dynamic process. So it requires a lot of engagement of a community network providers to keep on updating itself, those kind of things. So this is something. Then there's in ISOC itself, there's a curriculum which called understand the broadband and build your own community network. Those are some of the examples which deal trying to simplify the language of a community networks. Definitely there are a lot more discussions about that, how you can translate these networks into the simplified version. Actually, there's a lot more work has to be done, not only in terms of creating a lot more curriculums or structures in a simplified manner, but also to impart these kind of things to everyone. Actually, for example, I had conducted two barefoot wireless engineering courses in two African countries, there's a lot more scope that it is required to be done. And each curriculum should have that. Now we are thinking that not only to define that curriculum for an African purpose, but how we can talk about that, what are the African context of a regulatory mechanism as well. It is really important that what kind of regulatory mechanism is attached to their own country. So there's a lot more policy and discourse action, which one of the problem which I see actually is that even as a researcher, we tend to write a very heavy sentences. It also need to be simplified so that any common person can understand.
Yeah, that's a really good point. I think we could all take that into account as researchers and and technical professionals from whatever perspective we're coming from, to maybe simplify our language a little bit and make everything more accessible to the people who could really use it. Can never be reminded of that enough. I've got another question here, which is, what do you think about the idea of creating a fund where communities and NGOs and regulators could apply together in tandem? And I guess regulators would have to pledge simplification of policy, and communities would build networks together with technical NGOs. Do you have any thoughts on that kind of hypothetical?
I think the idea is nice, but implementing this kind of a thought process is a challenge in each country. For example, in India, when the government has been changed, when the government is changing and trying to be repressive, then it is really required to have an innovation kind of, this kind of funding will definitely help actually, not only for the small operators, but also for our small operators to take out, to reach out to the connectivity and take the connectivity in wherever they want to take it. Definitely the engagement of the government is really required, to support this kind of a fund or innovation if it happens actually. But for example, I can say that in a country like India, even if a central government says something, when it reaches to the rural region, it is not there actually. So the coordination as well as the communication between the state central government to the regional government has to be there. So those kind of advocacy also needs to be there. There's a need to understand that if it is if the government is trying to change some policy and thing, then it has to be passed on to the regional level as well. And yes, definitely it is also required to have a best sharing practices who have been benefited by these kind of resources actually. So there's a, specifically in Asia Pacific region, there's a lot more required to do such kind of a thing.
That's great. Yeah, thank you for that. So we only have time for a couple more questions, but we do have several more questions in the queue. So what I am going to do is I'm going to ask you a couple more, Ritu, and then after the session is over, we'll answer the remaining questions in text form, and I'll include them on the recording that's going to go up on the YouTube channel so that all the questions will get answered, but just not necessarily live. So one question that I had for you is, based on all of your experience working with community networks and working on these really dense regulatory issues, I'm wondering if you could talk a little bit about what are the human rights implications of internet access? It's kind of a big question, right? There's some discussion about whether internet access should be a human right. But then on the other hand, there's also another conversation that needs to be had about how internet access enables or curtails just a variety of different human rights. And I'm wondering how you think about internet access and rights.
Personally, if you ask me, then I definitely say that access to the internet should be the basic human right. Internet is not a luxury anymore, but it has become a necessity of any user. One of the things that enables internet is to access of their other basic things which I require. Let's talk about the specific scenario right now. What we are facing is a coronavirus, and we all are sitting into our homes and being isolated. Internet is giving us a provision to not only to access and communicate with each other, but to access the and utilize some of our resources, basic needs to each other. Whether I have to ask for a water, or whether I have to ask for a medicines, or I have to go for a such kind of a things. I may not need to go to the out of the door, out of the, my home, but I may get a delivered through the some kind of a internet if I have an internet services. So it not only enables that access to information, but also helps us to use it for other human right purposes, actually, whether it's access to health services, uniform access to education services, or uniform access to my rights or my choices or my other kind of all other sort of a thing. In that sense, definitely I feel that that uniform and universal access to the connectivity enables the human rights, enables the human rights in multiple channels, actually. In multiple channels, whether it, and it does not mean that whether I should be, if I'm not using internet, doesn't mean that I can't avail it. So I should have a, it should not be seen as a luxury anymore, but it should be seen as my right and my choices of using it, of using the internet access as my daily life routine. If I use it for the purpose of a health, or even if I use it for the purpose of a entertainment, it should be my choice. It's a choice that anyone should have it, like whether it's a food, or it's a water, or it's a basic necessity of a lives, like water and sanitation. If I need it 24/7, then I may need a 24/7 internet access as well. It provides, and whether I'm able to avail the information or not, it should be also my choice. So doesn't matter whether the choice is mine, and it is the choice of a as a human being, but it has to be provided uniformly and universally to the citizen by the state.
Sorry, I didn't unmute myself. That's great. Thank you so much, Ritu. And I'll just close with one last question, which came in from a viewer. It's a common one that we hear, I think, in relation to community networks, which tend to be sort of smaller scale, local solutions to challenges related to access. And so the question that came in is really about scalability. So a lot of times donors and NGOs are looking for scalable solutions to inequality of access. And so the question is about whether you can think of any solutions that can be scaled in any country. But I kind of want to expand that question a little bit and ask whether that is the core question here when we're talking about community solutions. Should we be talking about scalability, or should we be using some other kind of language?
I think the scalable is one of the things that we always think about it. Scalable either, or it's a replicable. Scalable can be a thing, whether my solution can be scaled to the another sort of a community itself, or I can replicate the same model into the other region as well, or I can scale this model to another model as well. So these kind of a two aspects where it is possible. Thinking that as a one of the model, as a community network model, if I have to take an example, which is only a medium to provide the for the committee to use it in a different and multiple ways. It could be used for the purpose of a handloom weavers. It could be used for the purpose of using as a medium to provide the information and health services. It could be used for different channels or a mechanism, but it depends upon the committee how they want to scale it, actually. So for example, if I have to scale this model into 10 surrounding of my villages, I may be able to scale it. But if I want to replicate this model to another country, I may not be able to replicate the same model into the another country. I may need to understand the demographic. I may need to understand the economic, I may need to understand the other scenario of that particular country. So it depends that what model has to be created. And that's the best thing about the community networks in sense, some sense that when they are going to deploy and install it, they try to understand the community need instead of forcing something on the community itself. So it's always good to create the model which is coming from the community, and it is easy to be scaled into different sort of a committees. Maybe there's a little bit of iterations into that model, but it is possible to scale it actually. And if since the beginning of any deployment, if the keeping in a mind of a scalability or sustainability helps the model to be more sustainable, as well as more to become a, instead of becoming a funded oriented, it becomes sustained from the beginning itself, since the beginning itself. So that is the one of the key aspects which I think making the model revenue based is always the key to key for any community network provider or any model actually.
Brilliant. Thank you so much, Ritu. Well, in that, I think I'm just going to end the seminar there with that final question. Like I said, there are a couple more questions remaining, but we'll go ahead and answer that after the seminar ends. And so it just remains for me to thank you one final time, Ritu, for joining us for this great discussion. I really appreciate you taking the time.
Thank you so much, Kira. Thank you so much. And thank you everyone for joining for the webinar. Thank you.
Great. And as I mentioned, the recording will be available on YouTube, and we will share that out widely. So, you know, please share with your networks and spread the word. So, thank you very much, and goodbye everyone for now. Goodbye.